morning, students. We have already completed our part, the life process, where we have discussed about the various aspects like nutrition, respiration, transportation, and excretion. Especially with context to the higher animals, where these are all the essential life processes, where without any of these, they cannot survive. And since they are carrying out these processes, and these are the characteristics shown by all the living beings. Now, apart from that, few more activities being carried out by the living beings, which may or may not be essentially required by the living beings, but a smooth survival will depend upon the certain kinds of movements, and these movements, they may be for the purpose of growth. These movements may be due to some other reasons as well. So these parts we have been discussing about. The next part, about the next lesson, that is the control and coordination in plants and animals. So first we will discuss about this control and coordination in animals, followed by the plants. Now, living beings, if we talk about the living beings, they show their growth and development and certain movements. Like for example, if we talk about the germination of the seed, if we talk about the germination of the seed, what purpose seed germinate? Naturally, seeds germinate to give rise to a seedling, and the seedling ultimately turns into the big plant, and that carry out its own life process. So, just from seed to seedling and to the plant, this is a kind of movement. And in this movement, what we find, that is root going downwards and the shoot moving upwards. So this is a kind of movement that shows the development. But certain other movements to the other living beings, like when if you talk about a cat. A cat running after a mouse. This movement, it is a voluntary movement where after observing the mouse, the cat runs after it. But on the other hand, if we put our hand unknowingly on a hot object, what do you feel? You just move your hand. What is it? This is also kind of movement. So movement may be carried out intentionally or unintentionally. So how these movements, they are being carried out into the living beings, and that we will be discussing about the control and coordination part. Now for the purpose of control and coordination, if you talk about in the animals, what is there? In the animals, especially if we talk about the human beings, they are having the two systems for control and coordination. One is called nervous system, and that is also known as the nervous control. And there is another one, that is endocrine system that is called capital control. So these two systems together, they give out the whole control act, coordination with the living beings. So now, what is the composition of the nervous system? What is the composition of the endocrine system? We will talk about in this chapter in details. And the later part of this lesson will talk about the control and coordination to the plant, because plants are also showing certain kinds of movements over there. Like you observe, the shoot always moves upwards, move toward the light, root always moves away from the light and inside the soil. So this nervous system is composed of neurons. Neurons are the structure and functional units of nervous system. It is, I mean, the different kinds of nervous systems, but everywhere one can find that the neurons are playing important role. And regarding neurons from the nervous tissue, you have already studied in the class 9. But yet, we shall be discussing over here about the structure of the neurons. Neurons are the longest cell found into the human body, and in a simplified neuron, all the neurons are of different kinds, different shapes, different depending upon the nature of work to be performed, or when the simplest part of the neuron, because I have drawn the neuron over here, this consists of a cell body that is known as the cyclone, having the nucleus, and this is having the dendritic structures arising from it, which are called dendrites, or the dendrons. And thereafter, this cell body is having a tail-like structure, what is called axon, and which ends again a hair-like structure, what is called the nerve ending. The certain neurons are covered with a sheath. So this is myelin sheath. So if sheath is there, this is called myelinated neuron. If sheath is not there, it's called non-myelinated, because we have got the two kinds of neurons, myelinated and unmyelinated. Normally, the neurons formed into our spinal cord, they are the non-myelinated, while the formed into the brain, they are called the myelinated neurons. So those myelinated neurons, they are gray in color, while non-myelinated are white in color. So regarding this one, we will talk about later on. We will talk about the spinal cord and our brain. Now, what happens over here, and what is the function of these neurons? Actually, neurons, they collect the message from the receptor side. Now, here the receptor has come up. Receptor. Obviously, the word has arise from the word receive, and the receptors, they are the specialized cells or tissues sensitive to a particular stimulus. Now, what are the stimulus over here? The stimulus means chemical or physical cause. So, different parts of our body, they are having the different kinds of receptors, which are sensitive to a particular kind of stimulus. For example, if we talk about our tongue, the upper part, if we talk about the tongue, this upper part, that is sensitive to sweetness, these two parts, the side wise, that is sensitive to sour, and this last part, that is the bitterness, while this is having the mixed. So a tongue has the different parts which are having the receptors and which are sensitive to the different kinds of stimulus over there, like sweetness with the stimulus, soreness is a stimulus, and the bitterness is also a stimulus over there. Similarly, if you touch a hot object, now this object, it is hot, you must not touch it. So this is the hotness is the physical cause, that is another stimulus. So whatever means the stimulus, the receptor which are sensitive to that one will receive it. You must have seen some of the doctors who are treating the skin infections, especially those people who are suffering from leprosy. Now, doctors, what they do? They just put a pin over there in the white part of the body, and the person doesn't feel any pain. Then it is a confirmed case of leprosy. Now, what happens in the leprosy? In the leprosy, the receptor over there that has been damaged, that's why the person is unable to receive the stimulus over there of the pin over there. So, this way, receptors are very, very important. In fact, our in the various parts of the body are having different kinds of receptors, like in our ears, we have got all our olfactory receptors, which are sensitive to the sound. In our eyes, we have got the optic receptors, the cells which are sensitive to the light. So that way, the various parts are having different kinds of receptors. So to the receptor sites, these dendrites are remained attached over there. So what happens? The stimulus is received by the receptors, and the receptors, they release certain chemicals over there, and these chemicals, they stimulate these dendrites, and the similar a certain kind of chemical reaction that starts taking place over here. And these chemical reactions cause the exchange of ions over there. Now, you must have studied in the electricity, when the ions of the charged particles, they move, that cause a development of the current. So literally here also the ions are start moving. So thereby a mild current is getting developed over here. And that current is passed through the cytosol and leaves the cell body through the axon. And the nerve ending, this is attached to the another this nerve cell, and this attached to the dendrites of the other nerve cells. So when this is